rigidity for point processes in related topics.
Thanks a lot to the organizer for keeping on organizing this conference despite the various postponements. So thanks a lot, and also thanks to Jonathan for the nice introducing talk this morning. And you'll see that we will come back to a lot of point processes that were introduced this morning. So it was just perfect. I didn't have the slide in advance, but you'll see that we'll come back. So it's going to be quite elementary. Yeah, I hope so. I was told that there were many students, so something went back to some basic things. Okay, so let's first introduce so some point processes of interest. So some of them we already get along with them today, and you'll see them again during this week. So just to clarify and to be complete, I just redefine very quickly what is a point process. So a point process is just a random configuration of points. So it means that you take a locally finite set, let's say in RD. Okay, and so I'll consider like simple configuration. Okay, so there's no each point is there's no multiplicity in the points. And so this set has a nice structure, and you can define probabilities on this set. And a point process is just a probability measure on the set of configurations. And so it's a random configuration of points. So it means that you can have a random number of points, or you can have a fixed number of points, but you forget about the numeration, the precise numeration of the points. Okay, so let's review some examples that we already encountered. So one of the, say, benchmarks for people working, for example, in spatial statistics or things like that, are Poisson point processes. So we saw Poisson processes appearing in Jonathan's for eigenvalues in some of random Schrödinger operators in some areas, in some regimes. We saw point processes also in other talks. So the main property is that you have independence. So if you look at the number of points in disjoint sets, the number of points are independent random variables, and the number of points in a given set is a Poisson random variable, and the parameter is just the measure of the set. Okay, so I write it with the density. This can be written just mu of k with a reference measure. Okay, so this is like, in a sense, what you could imagine, like the more random point processes you can imagine. And then I'll describe, so I'll go to random matrices. So one example of a random matrix ensemble, I don't know if we already encountered this one, but it's just the Ginibre ensemble. So there are no symmetries. You just take an n by n matrix, and you fill it with complex normal, Ginibre is a complex, the complex ID Gaussian variables. So you have a random matrix. This is the Ginibre ensemble, and you can write the joint law of the eigenvalues of the Ginibre ensembles. And so it has, so this morning, Jonathan wrote the joint law for the Hermitian case, okay? But it has exactly the same structure. So you have the van der Waals determinant with the beta here, which is equal to 2. and the Gaussian part, okay? And this is, okay, the same kind of point process, but it's on the plane, it's on C, instead of being a real point process. So we can have a look on what these point processes look like. So you have a Poisson on the left. It's not exactly a Poisson because we fix the number of points and just draw them uniformly inside the circle. And so you see that you have a lot of randomness. In particular, you have empty regions and clusters that can appear. Okay, it's just like as random as you could imagine. And here, it's a realization of a Ginibre matrix. So you see it's still random, but in a sense, it's more organized and there's no big empty regions. And so you feel that there are this repulsion between points that is readable in the joint law, that is that appears in the in this realization of the Ginibre ensemble. Okay, so let's go on with the same say all other processes that have in a sense the same flavor. So, for example, you can look at Gaussian analytic functions. So, one of them quickly appeared also in Hoffer's talk. So, this was with the normalization square root of n here. So, you take an IID sequence again of Gaussian. The Gaussian random variable, and you form this analytic function. And if you look at the zeros of this function f, then it is again a random. It is again a point process. Sorry, and this point process has also a very nice structure. So it's called the hyperbolic graph, the hyperbolic Gaussian analytic function. And hyperbolic refers to the fact that the zero, the set of the zeros, has invariance through hyperbolic isometry of the hyperbolic plane. Okay, so I won't really detail. So I just wanted to give you processes of different flavors, say. So I won't go very much into the details, but for those who know what are determinantal point processes, I'm just mentioning that so Perez and Dirac showed that it has a nice determinantal structure, and the kernel here is explicit and nice. So you can if you don't know what is a determinantal point process, for now you can just forget about that. Okay, and so it's a point process on the unit. Okay, so as one of the main topics of the conference is random Schrödinger operator, I should also mention also some processes related to random Schrödinger operator, and in particular, a very important, a very famous one is the Airy beta point process. So it's exactly the structure that we saw this morning in the Jonathan's talk. You have a Laplacian, and here your random potential is just so x plus a field here that is given by a white noise. Okay, and what is so if you look at this operator with so on R plus with directly boundary conditions. Okay, so it has a pure prong point spectrum, and you can consider the eigenvalues, and the eigenvalues is what is called the Airy beta point process. So in fact, it's minus Airy beta because we like to look at Airy beta because it is one of the links between random Schrodinger operator and random matrices. Because if you look at so these Jacobi matrices that we saw this morning, introduced by Alan and Ioana Dimitriou, so this model is called the Gaussian beta ensemble, and if you look at the eigenvalues of the G beta E near the edge, so near the largest eigenvalue, then the limiting process is the Airy beta process. Okay, so you can see it just, I mean, if you don't want to think about random matrices, you can just define it as the spectrum of the random Schrodinger operator that I wrote here. But if you like random matrices, it's also good to know that it's related. It appears as an asymptotic of a random matrix model. Okay. Sorry. So if we you could see it on the picture, and if I would have two pictures of the other processes, well, we can see when we look at realization of these processes, and when we look at the mathematical structure, is that it has always some kind of repulsion. Okay, it has. I mean, those are repulsive particle systems. Okay, but okay, if I want to define what is a repulsive system, what is a, say, negatively correlated system, I mean, it's not obvious how to handle this kind of properties, and there are various properties of these or questions that we can ask about these processes that are somehow related to repulsion, to the fact that they are repulsive. So one of the properties that can be looked at on these to like quantify or handle this repulsion is what is called hyperuniformity. I just mentioned it, but I want to really insist on this fact. But let just mention it. So hyperuniformity is related to the variance of the number of points. So if I look at, let's say, a ball of size R, and I look at the variance of the number of points of the configuration in a ball of size R. So in the case of a Poisson point process with the density, the variance will be of order the volume, okay, because it's a Poisson. This guy is a Poisson and a variable, so the variance is a parameter of the Poisson, as it's proportional to the volume. And so, if the variance is less than the volume asymptotically, we saw that it's hyperuniform. Okay, so it means that so it's a kind of rigidity in a sense, not in the sense that I will define, but it means that when you go on, I mean, if you make more realization, you will see less fluctuations for hyperuniform point processes than for Poisson. Okay, so there is less randomness, less variability, less lower fluctuations. So it's a very interesting property, but I won't discuss it in detail here. So the property that I will discuss in more detail in this talk is called number rigidity. So where is number rigidity? erase, so I hide the process inside. I assume that I know the configuration outside, and I'm wondering what kind of information do I have on the process inside. So for Poisson, for example, it's completely independent. So the configuration outside doesn't bring me any information on the inside. Okay? On the opposite, if the point process is number rigid, it means that once you know the configuration outside, the number of points inside is completely determined. It's deterministic. Almost sure that was. Okay, so you know the number of points. So I have erased 3 points. Okay, if I redrew a realization conditionally of the exterior, then I'm sure process is number rigid, that I will have again 3 points, not in the same position, but I will have 3 points. So the idea is that it's too costly. It costs, say, a kind of infinite energy to add a point or to withdraw a point. Okay, and because you have this rigidity that makes prevents you to make the number of change of points change. Okay, so this is a property I will talk about. So just the definition. Okay, halfway process and number rigid. If for any bounded Borel set there exists a measurable function, depending of course of the Borel set, such that the number of points inside the domain B is a deterministic function of the configuration outside. Okay, and so I will discuss what we know about number rigidity. Is it clear so far? Is it what kind of question we are asking? Okay. So the main tool that we have to handle number rigidity is a criterion due to Gauche and Perez. And it says the following. So you have a point process, you have a bounded set, and you assume, so you will play this game. You will construct a sequence of functions that are 1 on B. Okay, so you will look at linear statistics. This is called linear statistics. So you will look at linear statistics, okay? And the Fn should be 1 on your domain. So up to an error, a uniform error, and you want the variance to go to 0, the variance of the linear statistics to go to 0, okay? And you also want the number of the linear statistics to be finite. So here, in particular, here, if the Fn are, for example, compactly supported, this condition is automatically satisfied because the configuration is locally finite. Okay, so I could replace this first assumption that just the Fn's are compactly supported. Okay, so I want to find test functions for which the variance of a linear statistics is going to 0, and which are 1 on the domain that I am interested in. Okay, so just a note. This is not so easy, okay? Because of course we know that if I just take 1 on B and 0 outside, then if you are a bit familiar with random matrix, we know that typically for the I don't know, for GUI, for example, or a lot of matrix models that we know how to handle, and the fluctuations of the number of points inside with b of order log n. Okay, so it's going to plus infinity, not to zero. Okay, so you have to work with smooth functions and play the game of having a very slowly decaying functions. I mean, it's not so easy to find such family of functions. But okay, assume that we found such a family of functions. So I show you that I give you the proof of the Gauche-Peres criterion. So it's not so often that we can show full proofs in introductory talk. So I'll take the chance. So okay, I want to compute. So you see, it's very easy. So you want to look at the number of points of your configuration inside gamma. Okay, so the number of points is just the sum of 1 for x in B. Okay? So then I say, okay, I know that Fn is close to 1, so I will subtract sum of x Fn, okay? And then I will compensate this. I will compensate this by adding the full linear statistics minus the point outside. Okay, so this minus this is just the sum of fn of x for x inside. Okay, and so this one, and this one compensate. And then I subtract and add the expectation. Okay, so this is just a clever decomposition. So now I'm done. why am I done? Because this does not depend on n. So I can write the same by taking the limit on the right side. Okay? So I take the limit on the right side. And so what happens? This guy, okay, this is uniformly going to zero on B, okay? So say this is less than the max of this guy on B times the number of points. This is going almost surely to zero. This guy, I know that it's variance, okay? So the variance here is going to zero. So this guy is going in probability to zero. Okay? So it's going in probability to zero. So instead of taking the limit on the whole sequence, I can take the limit on a subsequence. So I take the limit along a subsequence for which this guy is going almost surely to zero. Okay, so this is going almost surely to zero. And this guy will give me the NB function, because this is deterministic, and this is a function of the outside. Okay, so this guy is exactly what I need. It's a deterministic function of the outside. Okay, so I'm done. Okay, so now I, as you understand, the principle is very easy, but it's going to be very hard. You have to be clever to find sequences of functions for which that fulfills the Gauche-Peres criterion. So now we'll give you a review of what is known. So what are the point processes that are known to be rigid? And you'll see that it's kind of hard to have an intuition. So I'm sorry, I put them in the not in the right order. I would like to start with this this example, and then I'll go back to the other ones. So ZD. Okay, so ZD is a point process in a sense, but of course it's a trivial one. And you perturb, so to each site you had a Gaussian invariant sigma, and you, so you pull, you deform the point, so this point will go here, this one will go maybe here, this one will be here, and you look at the results. Okay, so very easy point process. Okay, is it rigid? It's not so easy to conclude. So what happens is that, so in dimension one, it's very easy to construct the F. It's just you take one on B, and then you decrease linearly, and you just have to adjust the slope to get the result. It's not in dimension two, it's a bit more tricky. And so in dimension one and two, it's rigid. Okay, so it means in a sense that you could, so in dimension one and two, in a sense, you know how to identify from which point you are the deformation. Okay, so the deformation can go far, but in a sense you can reconstruct the correspondence, the coupling between the point, the x and the x plus yx. And in dimension three and more, it depends on the strength of the perturbation. Okay, so if you have a small, you have had a wise with small variance, it's still rigid, but if the variance is large enough, you lose the information and it's not rigid anymore. So it's a nice example that you can see what happens. Okay, so now let's go back to the examples that I introduced in the first part, and ask whether or not they are rigid. So of course, at the finite level, for Ginibre of size n, rigidity is just trivial. I mean, you have n points in total. If you know the number of points outside your domain, okay, you have k points outside, and then you have n minus k inside. I mean, there's no point in asking about rigidity. But I will consider the infinite Ginibre process. So it means that I look at the eigenvalues of Ginibre, okay, and I let n go to infinity, and I scale so that there is an average 1 point per unit of volume. So the infinite Ginibre is easy to define through the determinantal structure, okay, because you have an explicit kernel at level n. It has a nice limit, so you can define the infinite Ginibre as a determinantal process on C with an easy, an explicit kernel. And so this process is indeed rigid, so it corresponds to, in a sense, what we saw on the picture. And Gaussian, so the proof was given by Gaussian Perez, and it was using estimates on the variance of linear statistics that are due to Ryder and Dirac a few years sooner. Okay, so we also saw a very important, another point process, which is very important due to its universality, which is the sine process. So it appeared, I think, also in geometrics, I don't know, not remember, but it already appeared in the talks today. So again, this can be seen in relation with random matrices. So you look at GV in the bulk. Okay, so the one, Buffetov gave some criterion, so you can read directly on the kernel whether it's rigid, and in particular, it could recover the sine kernel case, and so cover the airy kernel in the for beta equals 2 and Bessel.
Question. No, I asked which
Buffetov.
Sorry,
Sasha.
That's what.
Yeah, sorry. Okay, and so much more recently, the rigidity was also shown for every beta, so the one I defined later, so by Godron Lamar, Gozali, and Liao. So this is again using variants of linear statistics, but it's a bit more involved. I mean, they can't apply directly Bloch-Peres criterion, so they have to work more. But basically, they have rigidity for every beta and also for other families of spectrum of random Schrödinger operator, not only every beta. They can play with the potential here. So for random Schrödinger operator with this structure and the potential growing faster than x, they got also rigidity. Okay, and so I will say a bit more about the sine beta process. So here again, if you look at these Jacobi matrices with general beta, and you zoom again inside the box, so for GUE you got the sine process, sine 2, which is a DTP, and if you make it for G beta, so these Jacobi matrices that were described in the previous talks, then you got as the limit of the block a sine beta, which is not so there are important contribution of Balco and Beck is here about this the sine beta process, and so this limiting process is more difficult to handle because you don't have the determinant description, but still we could show a rigidity. So there were more or less at the same time two proofs. So Scheibe and Najmudo got rigidity for all beta using Gauche-Barre strategy, and with De Redardi Leblé we had another proof, and hopefully if I have time I'll talk a little bit about our strategy, which is a bit different. Okay, so now if we go to Gaussian analytic functions, so here I have ID Gaussian coefficients, but I can consider different Gaussian analytic functions. So this one we already encountered, which is the hyperbolic GAF. This was shown to be non-rigid by Allroyd and Sowell, but the planar one, so when you normalize by square root of k factorial, this one is was shown to be rigid by Gauche and Peres, and this one is has a funny property, which is that if you fix the configuration outside B, you fix the number of points, but you fix also the barycenter of the point, so it's barycenter rigid. It's not only number rigid, but it's only barycenter rigid, which is kind of funny. So it has more rigidity. And just show, but it's even more mysterious. So if you take the hyperbolic graph, so it has a kernel, which can be written like that. And then if you, so this is called the, this is a Bergman kernel. And Q1 play the game of looking at sub-Bergman kernel, sorry, it's a leftover in French. So you look at the same kind of kernel, so typically the same kind of kernel, but you don't look at the whole, I mean, you consider N in a subset of N. So you play with a kernel with a lacunary, say, subset of N. Then you can construct example for which this is which. But okay, this is more, maybe more anecdotic. Okay, and yeah, so other very new, brand new results is that so Ginibre in dimension D has the structure of a Coulomb gas. So it means that so let me just go back to the joint law. So here you have a potential, and here if you would write this term in times inside the exponential, you would have minus sum over ing of log of zi minus zg. So we say that there are a logarithmic interaction between the points, and this is called in statistical physics Coulomb gases. So so Ginibre is an example of Coulomb gases and Coulomb gas in dimension 2, and you can play with beta, so for all betas, these are Coulomb gases in dimension 2. And okay, it was complicated to handle the statistics, but very recently, Leblay and one of his postdoc, Thibaut Vasseur, could show that Coulomb in two dimensions is rigid. But Eric Thomas, which is a student of Sylvia Sarfati, could also very recently show that in three dimensions, Coulomb is not rigid. So I don't know if it's reminiscent. I mean, I put it on the same slide as Bertrand Lattice's, but I don't
does
know if something could. Sorry.
Does that apply three dimensions and higher, or like four dimensions?
Ah, oh, I think. Sorry, I think it's dimension three or more.
That's what
here
I'm
also,
yes.
Yeah. Sorry,
yeah.
I put 3D, but it's yeah. Okay, so in the few. Remaining in the remaining time, I will just try just a little bit to explain you. So I told you that for the sine beta, we had like a method which is completely different from Gauche-Perret strategy. So not dealing at all with the variance of the linear statistics, and based on a tool from statistical physics, classical statistical mechanics. Called DLR equation. So DLR is from Dobrushin, Lanford, Buell, so like the godfathers of mechanical statistics a long time ago. And I'll try to explain what it means and how it relates to number rigidity. Okay, so this Dirac equation, so assume that we consider a particle system with pairwise interactions. Okay, so I have for a configuration H, I define an energy which looks like that. So it's the sum of pairs of, so I make it stationary, okay, so depends just of X minus Y. And here I have a function coding the interactions. Okay, so pairwise interactions, and I consider the associated Gibbs measure. So beta is interpreted as an inverse temperature, and so the measure is proportional to exponential minus beta times the energy of the configuration. higher dimension, you have 1 over, it should be norm of x, sorry, here. So S equals d minus 1 is Coulomb in higher dimension, but you can play with S and have more general. But this is not so important, so just forget about the particular examples, but it has to be pairwise and Gibbs measure associated to a pairwise interaction. Okay, and so this is defined for a fixed number of points. Okay, so a point process with a fixed number of points, and I want to make this should be a big N, so the number of particles going to infinity, and define a thermodynamic limit. Okay, so like the infinite Ginibre with respect to Ginibre N, or sine beta with respect to eigenvalues in the bulk, etc. So usually I need to do something in general for the model that I showed you. This won't be possible as it is. So I have to add or subtract a background. So this can be interpreted as follows. This is the energy of a configuration, and I assume that I have a background which is just uniform with opposite charge, okay? And so here I have a minus J of, so each of the point of the configuration is interacting with the whole background. It's called sometimes Gillion in physics. So this will help to indeed get a thermodynamic limit. And another thing that will help is that, so it's called the empirical field. So sometimes it's very hard to show that gamma n indeed converges, but it becomes a bit easier if we perform, so it should be tilde, if we perform, so just we forget about the origin in a sense, so we take a uniform, a random origin of a random, instead of choosing zero, you just shift uniformly. So it's almost the same process, but you have a little bit of randomness in addition that helps you define the limit. And with this procedure, you can define the limiting Coulomb, limiting this process. Okay, and now, so for example, it's very different with respect with how, for example, the sine beta was defined at the beginning. Okay, the sine beta was, for those who know the story, it was defined through what is called the Brownian carousel, so stochastic, families of stochastic PDEs, etc. So it hasn't, so when we worked on the sine beta, one of our motivation was to say, okay, this should be, it's defined in a complicated way, but it should be a beta ensemble. It's a beta ensemble, so can we define it as a beta ensemble? Okay? And this is more or less what the DLR equation are doing. So to get the DLR equation that I will show you in the next slide, you need to understand the cost of moving a point inside a configuration. So you have your configuration gamma, and you compare the energy with for a point at x in comparison with a point at zero. Okay, so this function represents the cost of moving a point from zero to x. Okay, so we call it the move function. And the idea is that if you know how to define this show that it exists. This is for almost all configuration gamma. So this is the hard part of the work. Then you can show that your process will satisfy canonical DLA equations. So what does it mean? It means that given the configuration outside and the number of points inside your lambda, sorry, that was my B, you know the law, you know how to write the law of your point process inside. And how does it look? Well, it's a beta ensemble, it's a Gibbs measure in a random potential, in a potential, which is the potential, in a sense, generated by the outside. Okay, so the move function say, okay, I look at my points, okay, and they are living in a potential created by the outside. Okay, so it says, okay, so we showed it, for example, for sine beta, and it says, okay, my process is a game, is a beta ensemble. Okay, and okay, I listed here the risk case, the parameters for which we know how to show the DLR equation. Okay, so if S is really really large, well, this is easy because basically the interaction is integrable. It was studied by Dorev and Vasseur between d minus 1 and d. We did it for sine beta, so this is s equals 0 d 1 1. And there's work almost finished, more or less finished by Lebly and Vasseur about DLR for Coulomb in 2 dimensions. And also, yeah, I wanted to emphasize that this is related to the notion of tolerance. What is tolerance? So rigidity is, okay, when I know the outside, the number of points is fixed. But then I can ask, okay, do I know more than the number of points? That is, if I condition by the outside and the number of points, can I, so does have the joint law have a density with respect to Lebesgue measure times, k times is the number of times in k. So here, the DLR equation tells you, okay, this is the case, and it even gives you an expression of the density. Okay, so in the example that I gave, in general, tolerance can be also complicated to handle. But if you go through the other equation, you get for the same price, it can be high, for the same price, rigidity and tolerance. And so the last thing I want to say is that if you have a process that satisfies canonical DLR equation in the framework that I gave, well, if your interaction is going to minus infinity for large x, then gamma is rigid. So this is what we used for sine beta. So very recently also Dorev and Vasseur showed that if it goes to zero, then it's not rigid. And so this could cover some cases of Ruiz-Yass for S negative, for example. But we don't know, I mean, we don't have yet any application of this one because we don't know how to show a DLR equation for a generalized. G is the interaction, is log or 1 over x to the s, and things like that. It's the.
Questions, comments? least in this case we have a transition.
But why is there a transition? There's the sigma. I'm not sure, but there's a link with transients and recurrence of the book.
More questions?
This value of sigma in the, like, how large should